Hi everyone, I'm here to talk to you about the Vietnam War. So let's get right into it. This is going to sound in the beginning a little bit like the Korean War, because like Korea, after World War II, Vietnam was divided. It was supposed to be temporary in that the North Vietnam was communist and South Vietnam was democratic, and they were supposed to have elections, but they never did. And the North Vietnamese communists end up trying to take over the South and make them communist as well. So the United States has to decide, what should we do? And this is when President Eisenhower is in office. And so he subscribes to the domino theory. And that idea is that when one country falls to communism, the neighboring countries will as well. And so with that, we get invested in Vietnam. We start sending lots of aid and soldiers, not there to fight, but they will help train the South Vietnamese army to try to stop communism from spreading there. So that starts with Eisenhower, thanks to his belief in the domino theory. That starts in 1955 and continues through President Kennedy's administration in 1963. At this point, Vietnam was not really on American people's radar. There's nobody really, you know, protesting this in mass numbers. But for 8 years, we were trying to stop communism from spreading by training the South Vietnamese army. That changes, though, with President Johnson, because there's an incident in North Vietnam in the Gulf of Tonkin. There's some confusion. It seemed like a U.S. ship was fired upon. But with that, Congress issues the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, which is essentially a blank check for President Johnson to do whatever is needed to retaliate, and in this case, stop the spread of communism. And so the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, a Quislet term, is a very important event, because this is what changes from us just sending military advisors to now actually sending ground troops to Vietnam. And so the typical American soldier is incredibly young. This is the youngest army that has ever been sent to war. The average age of an American soldier was 19 years compared to World War II, which was 26 years old. You can see that at the height, about 500,000 soldiers will be deployed at one time. Altogether, there are about 3 million Americans will serve in this war. The fighting in Vietnam was very different from other wars. As you can see here, there were battlefields of jungles and rice paddies. The army that were fighting in Vietnam was much weaker, but that didn't. But they didn't fight large battles against us. Instead, they would hide in these jungles and force the U.S. troops to come and look for them. And then they'd usually kind of strike and run. This is what's called guerrilla warfare, and it's how smaller, weaker armies can kind of prolong a war. But also in the jungles, you'd had animals like snakes, tigers, leeches, other things that posed a threat to the American soldiers. Here you can see some soldiers going on patrol. This typically meant walking a specific path, trying to look for the enemy. But because the enemy was, of course, fighting on their home turf, they knew the land better. And so it was often common for U.S. soldiers to walk into ambushes. What else was different about fighting in the Vietnam War is the fact that there was a group of soldiers called the Viet Cong, or the VC, that were fighting in the South, but for the North. So the VC are communists in the South that are fighting for the North. And so oftentimes the VC were farmers by day. And so it was only at night that these VC would meet up and fire upon US soldier bases. So therefore, when the US soldiers would come across a village, you could never really tell who was a friend, who was an enemy. You can't recognize who's VC and who's just a South Vietnamese person that's on the U.S.'s side. Here you can see a U.S. soldier questioning some South Vietnamese villagers, again, trying to find VC, but it's hard to tell who's trustworthy. Here's even a 23-year-old South Vietnamese girl that turned out to be VC. So very hard to figure out who's your enemy. Another thing that was different is for decades, the Vietnamese had been fighting against the French. And so during that time, they constructed a very elaborate, intricate system of underground tunnels. And so this is going to require some unconventional techniques, because the enemy literally was hidden. Here you can see just how elaborate this underground tunnel system was. Oftentimes, the the VC would fight the U.S. troops, then they'd disappear into these tunnels for days, oftentimes never to be found. So you would not want to be this guy here, a tunnel rat that had to go in there and try to chase the VC out. What else made the Vietnam War different was that there's a high amount of civilian casualties. Here you can see like U.S. soldiers trying to shelter this Vietnamese family during a firefight because they're fighting, you know, literally in these people's backyards. There is a famous incident, that became famous a couple years after, called the My Lai Massacre, in which some U.S. soldiers led by Lieutenant Callie, who's pictured here, ended up slaughtering a village. They thought that there were VC there, but turns out that they were not. And the public finds out about this a couple years later, is going to definitely raise eyebrows. So when did American public opinion really start to turn against the war? Because again, like I mentioned, this wasn't really on people's radar when we sent advisors, once we sent ground troops. There were some people that protested, but not in the mass numbers that we might have seen in movies. That all is going to happen after this event, the Tet Offensive in 1968. Tet is the Vietnamese New Year, the biggest holiday in most important holiday in Vietnam. And both sides agreed to a temporary ceasefire for Tet. But despite this agreement, the Viet Cong had spent months secretly planning an attack. And as you can see on the map on the left, all of those different red spots are cities that were simultaneously attacked by the VC and the North Vietnamese and took the Americans by surprise. And so here you can see American soldiers pinned down in our own embassy in South Vietnam in Saigon. So at first, during this Tet Offensive, this surprise attack launched by the North Vietnamese and Viet Cong, it went very, very well for them. But eventually, the United States and South Vietnamese forces are able to regain all of the territory that was lost. But the Tet Offensive was broadcast on the news to Americans, and they thought that for this 3 years of fighting, that things were going pretty well. And the Tet Offensive revealed that we weren't even close to winning the war. And this is what made people start to doubt if it was worth being there. The Tet Offensive is what marked a turning point in terms of public opinion. And you can kind of see that with this graph pulled at the bottom that shows that after the Tet Offensive, right here, really things start to change and more people started to think that the Vietnam War was a mistake. So there's also a draft that's implemented after this in 1969. In fact, there'll be a few more after this. Of the 3 million Americans that are going to serve in the Vietnam War, 2.2 million of them were drafted. So people started to really protest the war in much bigger numbers after the Tet Offensive, including the counterculture movement that Mr. Irvin spoke to you about last week. So I won't go into tons of detail here. But remember, they, you know, a lot of times listened to different music, you know, sometimes did drugs. And counterculture just means you're going against authority. You disagree with society. There was a big protest, anti-war protest out in Chicago outside the Democratic National Convention. Again, Mr. Irvin kind of talked about this last week. Remember, things got ugly, and this was all broadcast to the world. You could see just kind of how much tensions there were between the anti-war protesters, in this case, the Chicago police. 1969, this was one of the huge anti-war marches. This was in Washington, D.C. And then, of course, Mr. Irvin talked about it as well, Woodstock, right? This culminating music festival that the backdrop was, remember, the year before, 1968, was just filled with turmoil. We had multiple assassinations, you know, Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, Bobby Kennedy. You had the Tet Offensive in 1968. And so in the backdrop of that, they had this huge music festival that they thought would be attended by like 100,000 people to kind of promote peace. 400,000 people show up in upstate New York. And so there was another kind of protest movement, a way people responded to the Vietnam War. President Nixon is then elected after Johnson, and he was elected in part on his promise to end the war. But instead, and that's what Vietnamization is. It's to be the gradual withdrawal of U.S. troops. And that is what Nixon promises. Instead, we actually end up secretly bombing Cambodia, and because there's a trail that was providing aid to the VC. And so Nixon ends up bombing these supply routes to try to stop the VC from continuing to have success. It was a massive bombing campaign, more bombs dropped here than in World War II, but still, regardless, the North did not surrender. Once the American public learns of this secret bombing campaign, they thought the war was coming to an end. There were more protests, including at Kent State University in Ohio. The National Guard is called there to try to keep the peace. One thing leads to another. Next thing we know, four people are shot and killed at these anti-war protests. So how did the war eventually end? In 1973, the United States agrees to a ceasefire and we withdraw our troops. The civil war between the North and South Vietnamese continued to wage on for two more years, but ultimately the North Vietnamese end up defeating the South. The war had a huge impact on the Vietnamese people. About a million civilians, a million soldiers were killed during the war. That's way more than all the other American wars combined. So just a huge devastating effect on the Vietnamese people themselves, civilians and soldiers. As far as Americans are concerned, about 58,000 Americans were killed. Many of the soldiers that lived, however, contracted cancer from Agent Orange, a pesticide that was used. And many of them returned home, but suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome. And ultimately, like I mentioned, Vietnam became one unified country that was under communism and still is technically to this day. The war, again, has a dramatic impact on American society. It lowers the voting age as people are saying, hey, how can they go off to war but not be able to vote? So it gets lowered to 18. The War Powers Act is passed, which is one of your Quizlet terms, which is going to reduce or require the president to notify Congress of sending troops abroad. And really the big thing is that the country becomes so much more cynical. As if you can see from this graph here, just how much less trusting the United Americans are of the government. Prior to Vietnam, about 75% of Americans trusted the government, but within 5 years of the war ending, that number had dropped to 25%. We've never really recovered since then. This is a picture of the Vietnam War Memorial, very powerful, moving exhibit in DC. All right, hope that helps.